Hello there, everybody. Welcome back to the Buddhist Center podcast with me, Chandradasa. I'm here this week at lovely Adastana in beautiful rural Herefordshire in England, in the United Kingdom. If you've listened to the podcast before, you've probably heard me say that a few times. We come here sometimes during the year, and there are always amazing people to meet, and it's always beautiful just to capture their voices, capture their stories, which is really what this podcast is about. We're bottling the magic of Buddhists, Buddhists who are alive today in the world and trying to figure out what it is to be a Buddhist in 2024, wherever they are. And in this case, in England. I'm very happy to say that I have a guest star on the podcast as my fellow team member this week, my friend Akasa Jyoti, who has done one or two podcasts in the past, somewhat reluctantly. But welcome to the podcast, Akasa Jyoti. It's very nice to have you on the team.
Thank you, Chandradasa.
How are you doing?
I'm well. It's very lovely to come and drop into this meeting and experience that positive atmosphere of all of the people gathering that you're evoking.
Well, I'm glad to have you along for the ride on this podcast, mainly because we're going to be talking with your friend, my friend, many people's friend, actually, Dharma man, serious meditator, someone who's soon to take on a big new responsibility in the Triratna Buddhist community, which we'll explore later. Welcome, Mahamati. It's lovely to see you.
Thank you, Chandradasa. I can remember my first meeting with you probably on an international order convention when you were just ordained.
Ooh.
By no means the first time that we're meeting.
I was saying that this podcast is really about stories and about voices. You have this beautiful baritone, resonant voice, which is going to sound fantastic on the air. I guess the reason we capture people's voices, literally, we record people and we record their stories of practice, is because I know as a listener, there's something about the magic of radio. You hear somebody's voice and they're talking about what really matters to them, and it sparks off something in me. It illuminates something. Life of the heart, of the soul, of the spirit. We all have names as Buddhists. We all have interesting names. And I thought, let's do names. Let's start with our names. Because I think some of the bottling of magic that can go on in our particular community, the Triratna Buddhist community, is captured in the names of order members. So Akasa Jyoti, tell us what your name means.
Akasa means sky or infinite space, and Jyoti is radiance, fire or light. So when I was introduced, Vajratara, who ordained me in 2016, described that as she whose radiance is like the sky.
Has it developed for you as a name? Have you come into different relationship with its meaning? Or
yes, definitely. I mean, the sky as a symbol feels like a very open image, and I feel grateful to be given that, because the sort of associations with it do change over time. One of my favourites actually is that it refers to an inner space rather than an outer space, a kind of imaginal space. Mm. Yeah, that feels very meaningful to me. And the Jyoti part, I've kind of developed more connection with over time, but felt shyer about, I think.
Shy about your joy? Shy about your delight?
Well, it's a more visible quality, yeah.
Mm. Do you think it's visible, Mahamati? Do you think she's well-named?
You're shy about your light? But Akasa Jyoti very much has it. Yeah. If those who haven't met her, they would find that. And those of you who know her, you will definitely know that she expresses her name very well.
It's funny when you say Jyoti, the reason I think of delight is got the word light in it. You're delightful in that sense.
Exactly.
You're of the light.
Thank you. And you, Mahamati, what does Mahamati mean? And what did Sangharakshita say when he named you?
Yes, that's right. So Sangharakshita gave me my name, and that was one of the greatest gifts of my life, to be ordained by him. Sangharakshita, the founder of our order, who carried out all the first ordinations, gave me my name when he ordained me in 1977. The meaning of my name, I can remember this, and also seeing this written down, was it means a great spiritual intelligence. That was his parse, his explanation of the meaning of Mati. Of course, most people know the meaning of Maha, like Mahatma, Mahatma Gandhi, great soul. Maha means great, but the Mati, it means spiritual intelligence, and it's a lot to live up to.
It is a lot. Actually, both your names is a lot, isn't there?
Yeah, well, it's all our names are.
All our names are quite a lot.
Each and every one of the order names.
More than a lifetime's worth of to live up to.
Yeah.
I don't know why this came to mind when you said you talked about the great intelligence. AI, artificial intelligence, is one of the kind of buzzwords of our time. And in a week, we'll even use AI to remaster this podcast. There's also human intelligence, but you're talking about something else, aren't you? There's the great intelligence. It's a bit mysterious.
It is mysterious. Sangharakshita also said that, I mean, this is, for me, quite awe-inspiring, is another name for Manjushri. And Manjushri is the Mahayana Bodhisattva of wisdom. So, yeah, it's wisdom. Wisdom. Big topic.
Mm. Wisdom that's lived and experienced.
Yeah, wisdom that's lived, that starts to transform one. Yeah.
Yeah. Gosh, I feel like we could end the podcast right there just with our names. Send everybody away, just reflect on our names. Let's go back to the beginning. Even before you received the name Mahamati, we were in a car yesterday, wending our way through these lovely tall hedgerows on these lovely roads in this beautiful corner of England. And we were talking a bit about what it is that lights us up. Again, light. What is it that lights us up in these key moments of our spiritual lives, particularly where we make a choice, make a commitment? How long is it since you became a Buddhist?
Well, I first came along to the then Friends of the Western Buddhist Order in 1976 when I was 21. And I asked to be a mitra just a few months later. And then I was ordained within a year. Yeah, I was ordained when I was 22.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So almost 50 years in this community.
I guess it is. I'm 69.
Amazing. I guess one question for me is, why would you say you're a Buddhist now after 48 years of practice? And how does that link to that magic that got you started in the first place?
I responded to Buddhism very quickly, but I didn't know anything about Buddhism before I went to the Buddhist Center. I'd say my adolescent years, my mother used to say I was quite dreamy. And I would say I was quite dreamy. And actually, I would say I was a little bit depressed. When I went to university, like, whole world opened up for me. But initially, it was not a spiritual world. It was a world of more like growth and development. Well, it was connected with a particular kind of therapeutic growth. And I also became very involved in far-left Marxist politics, wanting to transform society. And I had this dilemma, which I was really conscious of in the summer of 1976. I had friends who wanted to change the world. I had friends who wanted to grow through therapy. But I couldn't align myself with either. When I came across Buddhism, the first thing I heard was Sangharakshita's lecture, The Meaning of Spiritual Community. So, I mean, if you're asking me what made me a Buddhist and what still makes me a Buddhist, I would always go back to the content of that lecture, what spiritual community really, really is.
How did you find your way to it? Was it a friend recommended? Did you just wander into a Buddhist centre? Did you just see a poster? What carried you on the wind into an FWBO, which is the old name for Triratna Centre?
What happened was I had a friend who was a philosophy lecturer at the university. I was studying philosophy, but he hadn't actually taught me. And he invited me round to tea to meet a couple of, well, I didn't know it then, but they were order members who'd come to start a centre in Norwich. And so we had exchanges over that evening. And a few months later, I bumped into that man, at least the long-term members of Triratna will know, Dave Amitra. And he'd been kind of looking out for me. And he said, "We've opened a centre. Would you like to come?" So I said, "Yes." And I did.
So in a way, it was already something very personal with a colleague, at least in this life, and a friend in this life. You've had this long career and you've occupied many important roles. I should also tell the audience, Mahamati used to work for the charity I currently work for way back in the day when it was reel-to-reel tapes we were distributing instead of audio on the internet like this. So you're part of a long tradition of people working in this area, but you've held lots of important jobs at different points in time. Are you still in touch with the thread of practice that brought you in when you heard that lecture by Sangharakshita through all of those roles? It's making you smile now. People can't see your face, but you're smiling. So what is that?
I'm glad you asked that because, you know, I didn't mention that lecture. It brought together these two threads of transforming the world and individual growth. But there was something else, which quite soon I recognised it's what one could call, as it were, the transcendent. But exactly what that is, I've been, in a way, unpacking or starting to find out ever since. I mean, day by day, right up to this moment, I'm finding out what is that something It's beyond just transformation of the world and beyond transformation of oneself. It's what we would call the transcendent, the lakutara, the beyond the... Well, I could say more about that, but in a way, yes, there is something that has kept me going, but all that within the context of the collective. So that's why I say the spiritual community, for me, it's been absolutely key right through. Mm. Of course, there have been times when I've been more or less in the flow, but yeah, mm. I hope that, if anything's stronger now mm. than it was, in a way, it grew, didn't it? Because when I first came along, I didn't really know what it was, but as I've mentioned, I can mention now, I very quickly asked to become a mitra and then to become an order member.
It's funny hearing you talk about this history, because when you mentioned just in passing that you were initially quite fired up about Marxist politics or left-wing politics, there's a big emphasis there on the collective, isn't there? It's a different kind of thing. It's a different discourse from the discourse of this community and of a Buddhist life, but you're so animated when you talk about the collective, when you talk about being part of something bigger, this in touch somehow with something transcendent, whatever that is.
It's good that you mentioned that, because the thing is about the collective, why I was so bowled over by that lecture, and within a couple of weeks I was saying to friends, what I've come across is so special. I couldn't understand why all my friends in Norwich weren't going to Norwich Buddhist Centre. It was like so amazing, you know, why aren't they all coming? Which of course they weren't. But what it was, in the political arena and also in the therapeutic arena, you couldn't find that collective engagement. Suppose with the political arena, you would sell these far left, well, I never actually tried to sell the very far left international Marxist papers and so on. I wasn't quite that far left, actually. But you would sell the paper and then you'd go to the pub. If you were involved in the therapy, you would go maybe for one evening a week or one weekend a month, and then that's it. And what I found immediately with Sangharakshita's vision is the whole of your life. So you could live your whole life with others trying to fulfill your ideals. Yeah, and I was excited. I still am quite excited, actually.
You are, aren't you? I mean, can I pick that up, actually? Because yeah. It was interesting to hear you say there, I couldn't understand why my friends weren't all at the Buddhist Centre yeah. too. Did they understand why you were at the Buddhist Centre?
Well... When I went along to the Buddhist Centre, I'd done 2 years at the University of East Anglia in Norwich, and I got permission to have a year out. So I wasn't on the campus much, but my close friends I was in contact with, one or two of them did come along. I remember one of them joined for a sevenfold puja, and they said, oh yeah, that's very Christian. In a way, they didn't have the response, which it wasn't an issue for me because my family is Jewish anyway. So I didn't have any touch of Christian conditioning particularly. But yeah, I don't think anybody else got involved.
But you found the community.
I did, didn't I?
You did, yeah. The talk turned into people.
Like... Yeah, it did. Yeah, but actually on the first evening, even before the talk, it was the people that I responded to. Even before the talk, because in those days... The standard format of a Triratna, then Friends of the Western Buddhist Order evening, was a meditation, a tea break, and then a recorded lecture by Sangharakshita. So even that first day, I connected with the people. I felt like they were so friendly, and we just seemed to connect.
Mm. In the show notes, we'll put links to those lectures. In fact, that lecture that you heard, the recording of it, yeah. so that anybody yeah, listening yeah. can go in and have the same experience of hearing that for the first time.
Yeah.
It's odd, actually, yesterday at this meeting, we were giving people a little sneak peek of AI-improved versions of those lectures, and it was very strong, wasn't it, to hear Sangharakshita's voice really ringing out, right out of the past, don't you? You could almost reach out and touch the voice in the air. It was amazing.
Mm, exactly.
So that is all great background to what's occasioned this conversation. If you're listening and you're not particularly familiar with our structures in our community, a keystone part of the structure, or maybe the architecture, of Triratna is the College of Public Preceptors. We'll hear more about that in a second. You've just been elected as the next chair of the college, which is a big responsibility. Before we talk about that specifically, for the people who don't necessarily know too much about the college, how do you see it as you take on that role? And how do you see its kind of vital relationship to the lives of everyone who's got a strong connection to Triratna, to our community?
Yeah, so this college is a college of public preceptors that was established by Sangharakshita originally in 1993. Public preceptor is somebody who publicly, he or she, ordains members of our order. And all the ordinations have a public preceptor and a private preceptor. And for many years, Sangharakshita was both public and private. So they're two ceremonies. I won't go into that in detail. In the early years, I never imagined anybody would ordain people apart from Sangharakshita, but obviously he must have worked out that's not going to be viable. And anyway, he wants to pass on the lineage of the tradition to others. So he first did that in the 1980s. I won't go into all the historical detail, but he first appointed a few order members, women and men, as the first public preceptors. And then gradually there were more and... Then in 2000, on his 75th birthday, Sangharakshita handed on what he said of his remaining, at least institutional responsibilities, and he appointed the first chair of a college of public preceptors, which was Sibuti. So when you ask me what is the role either of the chair of the public preceptors or of the college, I have to pause a bit because I haven't even started doing it. So obviously I'm reflecting exactly what I've been asked to do, but I have been a public preceptor since 2004, so obviously I've been reflecting on what it means to be a public preceptor and a member of the college, which now has about 50 members worldwide. We're very international. Our kind of central beginning responsibility is to train mitras who want to be ordained for ordination and then to publicly ordain them, and then to maintain a lifelong connection with them of spiritual friendship, O Kalyana Mitrata. And along with that, our responsibility is to ensure that there are private preceptors, which sometimes public preceptors, they also do private ordinations, but there's also many more private preceptors than public preceptors. Suppose there's about, historically, about 350 order members have been private preceptors. And we need to make sure the right people are chosen for that responsibility. So there's a process and so on. And so our responsibility is also for the training of private preceptors and for the carrying out of ordinations. And there's a lot of other responsibilities, but everything else comes from there. The good thing about that, you've got college members who are order members, but then you've got the whole order. And fundamentally, we are taking this responsibility as order members, but it's a very specific responsibility. And together with all order members, we have a Triratna movement. It's a collaborative process, which I'm really looking forward to, actually. Yeah. I've already started talking to quite a lot of order members in anticipation of having this particular responsibility.
I was just interested listening to you then, Mahamati. It reminded me of this piece that Sangharakshita says at the end of what is the Western Buddhist Order about all order members and everyone involved in our community must play their part in taking care of this indefinable spirit that animates and kind of comes through.
Yeah.
What I'm hearing you say is that the college have a very particular role to play in taking care of that indefinable spirit, which again took me back to the first ordinations where Sangharakshita is describing the process of ordaining someone as witnessing a coincidence of understanding of going for refuge. And that's what the college are continuing to carry in trying to kind of preserve the integrity of a system of training that we've received from Sangharakshita.
Yeah, we do have a system of training which is tried and tested and seems to me after, 55 years, more or less, we can see the results. You can talk to lots of order members and they will tell you the fruits.
Going back to, you referred to a time where Sangharakshita conducted all the ordinations. And I was thinking of how he describes that first ordination ceremony in a very personal way. He describes himself witnessing another person's going for refuge, which I guess is to experience a sort of resonance of practice with the ordinand. So I was wondering for you whether you could say something about what it's like to stand in relation to someone as their public preceptor. I suppose the personal nature of that connection, because I think the College of Public Preceptors can be conceived of as a, in kind of organisational terms or as an institution, but actually the nature of the responsibility is primarily this very intimate process of witnessing.
It's personal, that's right. In a way, it's quite humbling because you're witnessing somebody else's aspiration and commitment, and all that has for them gone into that, their whole life, and hearing, as one does in the ordination training, different people's life stories. To get to that point, often it has been really quite something. And there they are, and you are putting the finishing touches to their ordination. You're putting the queso around their neck, and they are reciting before that the refuges and 10 precepts that we have. So yeah, it's humbling in a good way. I just feel a lot of care and love for those people, and I'd want to see them flourish. Essentially, that's what the College of Public Preceptors is. So I'm glad you say that, Akasa Jyoti, because otherwise it can seem just like it's an institution, but basically it's a number of individual order members who are in that relationship with the people before ordination, at ordination, and yeah, after ordination.
And in relationship with every single order member between you.
Well, if you look at the order, there are those who were ordained by Sangharakshita, and then there were those ordained by, obviously, those that followed him, and a few of those have now died. We've lost them. Some of them have retired. But yeah, the majority of order members have been now ordained beyond Sangharakshita. Yeah.
There's a lot there, isn't there? I'm going to try and sort of do the ChatGPT recap of all of that. If you sort of try to fuse the institutional bit and then the very deeply intimate, very moving relational part of it. So the college is responsible for the practical business of ordaining people into the order, but it also, from what you're saying, it stands for the sort of deep integrity of the order as an effective Buddhist community of practice, that we believe our system of practice, our system of training works as part of a very rich and an old Buddhist tradition.
Absolutely, absolutely. I mean, in a way, I'd say that is the fundamental responsibility of public preceptors and members of the college, which is to do our best to retain our fidelity to our tradition. Now, certainly speaking for myself, as the years go by, I do have confidence in our tradition, and I do find it works for me personally, and I do see many other order members for whom it really works. So fundamentally, that's what we're doing, and it stems from the ordination ceremony itself.
And again, just going down layers into that, so even ordination can sound very formal. Just to be clear, this is you witnessing people who've decided to change their life quite profoundly, having come across Buddhism and the Dharma. And even underneath that, there's a layer where what's actually going on is people are trying to find something meaningful, a way to live that meets suffering in the world, in their own life, in the world around them, in the relationships they have with loved ones, with strangers, with politics. And they're reaching for something quite beautiful, quite mysterious in there. And all of that is in both the formal structures and the architecture, like a beautiful piece of architecture, a keystone. But it's also in that moment where you're standing with someone who you're taking up a role as a real friend to them, aren't you? And you see them, and they know that you see them.
I mean, the more that I reflect on the Dharma, or at least at the moment, I find that I often think that it all comes down to, well, you just mentioned it, suffering and the end of suffering, which means happiness. I reflect a lot on that, and I also reflect a lot on what is true happiness. And I mentioned earlier on about that element of something else, or let's say the transcendent, that I responded to right at the beginning of my contact when I heard that lecture, Meaning a Spiritual Community. And for me, that has something to do with true happiness. And that is what the ordination offers for ourselves, but also to share with others. Now, you might wonder what I mean by true happiness.
If you have the answer, could you tell people? Listen up, folks.
Well, it's an interesting one, isn't it? You know, all these years doing the meditation on loving kindness and metta bhavana, I often used to think of happiness as freedom from the particular suffering that I have or others have. But then thinking more deeply, you know, every day I meditate on a Manjushri, and there are these opening verses which speak about wishing that all beings would experience happiness and its causes. be free from suffering and its causes, never be parted from happiness, and dwell in the condition of equanimity. And gradually reflecting upon that, it dawned on me, and I find it really helpful to think, what is that happiness? And that happiness, it's a transcendental happiness, basically. And that transcendental happiness seems to me is a freedom from grasping and hatred and delusion. And that happiness is a safe refuge, and it's possible. It can be shared. So we are responding to suffering. I see Triratna, primarily that's our mission, to respond to suffering in the world and to give a signpost and a way to get to true happiness. Of course, along the way, there are so many terrible, terrible problems in the world, and we would try to help where we can with just sort of basic human happiness, but ultimately it is that transcendental happiness, in my understanding, that we are aiming for.
Mm. People might hear the word transcendental and think, well, what does that mean? Listening to you there, I suddenly cried, I don't know if I've ever thought about this before, but I thought, it's the fact that we share it that makes it transcendental. It's definitely not just about us. It's not something we grasped or held. The whole nature of it is a giving hand. It's not a hand that's opening instead of a hand that's closing.
Yeah, because in a way it's transcendental in two ways. It's not dependent on the conditions of craving, hatred and delusion. Okay, so you can't grasp it. And secondly, yeah, exactly what you say. That sounds just great. You know, it's not mine, it's not yours. And that can be what can unite us if we can at least taste that as we do collectively. Mm. And it's open to anybody. We in Triratna want to welcome anybody who wants to share in whatever happiness, to whatever extent. Of course, there's plenty of suffering as well, so we have to share our sufferings. So it can't all be the bright side.
Yeah.
Can it?
Well, that's it, isn't it? I mean, even this podcast, something as mundane as a podcast, we're sharing lives, and those lives are mixed.
Yeah.
They're moving towards something.
Yeah.
They are part of a stream of practice that's going on, but they're mixed. I think it's quite difficult to have a conversation about the transcendental. I mean, it's so easy for it to move into abstraction and conceptualization, all of which can be quite interesting in a certain way, but it doesn't really necessarily touch deep. One of the things I'm really enjoying about this conversation so far is this lovely collision that's happening between the bigness, as it were, of the task of practicing within an ancient tradition and making that relevant, and also the beautiful intimacy and personally felt nature of that, always in relationship, going back to your first experience of the idea of community and the experience of community at that first evening at the Buddhist Center.
Right.
I'm aware from talking to you yesterday, you absolutely did not want to become the chair of the college. There was an election process. That's part of a different aspect of the life of our order. And you were not up for doing that. But what I love about the story here is that you ended up taking it on because your friends really wanted you to do it. That's quite a strong thing to let in. Your friends, in a way, chose you. That means they believed in you. They knew your practice. They knew you as a man. And they decided to say something to you that has now changed your life again in a particular way. What's that like to be held in that experience of friendship that's so intimate and also so strongly direct?
I like to answer that, but I just like to say why I didn't want to do it. I mean, just to be clear, it's not an election in the sense of it's a voting system. The college has its own process, so it's done completely by consensus. This is a very open, transparent approach that the college historically has. Some friends had asked me whether I would be interested in being nominated because that's the way it starts. And I had said and thought and felt, don't nominate me. I had literally said it will kill me.
Ooh.
And I'd just like to explain what I meant by that, because it probably relates to what I'm talking about, the importance of having something transcendent at the forefront of anybody's Dharma life, is that I thought I would get dragged into all kinds of meetings and issues and problems that I didn't want to be, and it wouldn't be helpful for me. But then, when it turned out that others thought I would be the chosen candidate, first of all, I saw that, well, the order and Triratna is so important to me, if this responsibility needs to be taken, I simply can't turn my back. So that was the first thing. And I just saw this in a moment. Akasajota, you were there, weren't you?
Yeah, I was. And actually, it was very, very inspiring witnessing that turning about in you.
Yeah.
It felt very much like a response to a call to serve.
Yeah, thank you. And what happened, I actually started to say, count me out, because some people had nominated me. I literally said, I'm sorry to say, but count me out. Then the current excellent chair of the college, Ratna Dharani, and the Kasa Jyoti, the excellent secretary,
you,
looked worried. At that moment, I realised, maybe I'm the one who needs to do this. First of all, I just thought, I can't walk away. I didn't know for sure that I'd end up doing it, but I can't walk away at this point. But then very quickly following that was, if I'm going to take this responsibility, I will find a way to do it that works for me. Mm. I've said to some people, if one's not careful, any kind of responsibility can destroy your soul. Soul destroying. So it's quite strong stuff, isn't it? But the thing is, any organisation or any community needs a lot of attention. And Triratna is no exception. But it is possible, and I convinced myself, I can do this in a way that is spiritually efficacious and I can continue to grow. And I'm not the only one. That's what everybody is trying to do. That's why I am sure I've been given a gift here, because I deeply believe that working in the context of our Triratna institutions and taking responsibilities is deeply transformative. I don't personally, in my own practice, use the language of insight a lot, though of course I understand that the language of insight is a traditional language. I think more in terms of deeper understandings, you might say that's just another word for insight, I don't know, which transforms one. And also the challenges of taking on a responsibility can really draw a lot out of one. It was a gift from my friends, and I told them, don't ask me, absolutely not. But I said, don't worry, if I do it, I will do it in a way that will work for me. So that's still how I think, nothing's changed.
Mm. Just listening to you, it's like listening to an arc. It's like watching something become an arc or a parabola through the sky. In some ways, you're saying at the start of that, you're not sure it's a really intuitive fit for you to take on a role like that. You're saying, no, thank you. This is not me. This is not what I need. And then you come into a relationship with your friends. Something happens, something maybe beautiful, mysterious happens. All of this somewhere is obviously, there's a line back to your own path of practice and commitment from that first evening at the Buddhist Center through to your own act of ordination of choosing this life. For me, when I think about that, I think about a path of love more than anything. It's like you're committing yourself to mode for the rest of your life. And that has been seen by someone, it's been seen by your friends. I suppose what all this implies is that the path of responsibility itself is a practice, like taking responsibility is a practice. It's not that you are in some fixed, ready state and therefore that's recognised, that you're on a path and presumably your practice is going to unfold from this point where you've decided to take this on.
Yeah, definitely. Right now we're at Adistana and there's a meeting of about 40, 50 board members who are taking responsibility, mostly in mainland Europe, some from overseas like Mexico. Chairs of centres and running different institutions like Wintour's Publications, Future Dharma Fund, and yourself, Chandradasa, who made an excellent presentation. And one of the joys of being here this week for me is just seeing how order members take responsibility, and it is a path of growth. And, you know, just about any of the people here, if you ask them, they will tell you, they will tell us how they're growing. If you're not growing, you won't want to do it. And also, it won't be inspiring for others. But in my own case, I had taken quite a lot of responsibilities in the past in Sri Lanka. I'm 69. I'll be 69 and a half when I actually start being chair of the college. It's a five-year term. Sangharakshita made it absolutely clear the chair of the college must complete their term. In a way, it's clear because you just want to know you've got that stability. So I'll be nearly 75. So I kind of thought I've done my bit. But of course, it's never like that. I thought I would like to spend more time learning to play the piano and learning to grow a few vegetables and going to the gym and leading a quiet life in Malvern, 5 miles across the hill from here at Adistana. And yeah, I was definitely involved in ordination training in Belgium and the Netherlands. I'll continue to do that. I've been president of some centres, some I've given up in order to be chair of the college. So it wasn't that I wasn't already contributing, but I didn't think I would take on such a major responsibility, in a way all responsibilities are. But yeah, life unfolded in a way I didn't expect.
I wonder whether you could say a bit about, we're using this phrase, taking responsibility.
Mm.
What does that mean? What does it mean to take responsibility?
Well, I mean, the first thing that I think is that when you're responsible, the buck for particular things stop with oneself. Whatever it is, if, you know, you're responsible for unlocking the centre every morning, you've got to do it. You've got to get out of bed. So for me, I need to do whatever is necessary. We haven't talked much about what the responsibility is, but first of all, that my colleagues in the college, we can function together as effectively as possible as a body. And also, whatever interaction with the order and movement we need to have, we can have that. I'm really excited about making as much as possible creatively of the college's relationship with all order members, working with those with specific responsibilities, whether, again, the word responsibility, isn't it? I mean, you know, if you ordain somebody, you've got a responsibility to be there for them. You've got a responsibility to exemplify what they have committed themselves to. So in a way, what I've noticed since agreeing to be chair of the college back in November last year, now 7 months through a year of preparation, it really is inviting me to step up in my own Dharma practice, which again, I think in Triratna, that will do for anybody. I have a responsibility to the college, to help the college, to the order. I feel a responsibility to respond to the vision of Sangharakshita, Urgyen Sangharakshita, our lineage. It doesn't really answer the question, does it? Because I guess I'm not answering the question in a dictionary way. I'm sort of giving examples of what you actually do.
To me, it seems to imply when we take responsibility, we're taking responsibility to create contexts, to create community that enables people to come into contact with the Dharma and deepen their practice. It's a kind of altruistic dimension of practice.
Yes, of course, Jyoti, I really appreciate you bringing that out. I have never found it helpful to think of Dharma practice from a purely individual point of view. I have Sangharakshita to thank for that. Of course, I have the whole tradition to thank for that, because right from the beginning, the Buddha exhorted his disciples to go out for the welfare of many, for the happiness of many. Bahujan Hitaya, Bahujan Sukhaya. When I have thought of Dharma practice as just my own practice, I've generally been pretty unhappy and got quite sort of confused. Whereas when there's been a way to engage with giving and working with others, it's tended to go much better.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Yesterday when we were talking about this, you described stepping into this role as a way of serving people who are seeking ordination.
Mm.
Serving people who are looking to dedicate their lives in a meaningful way.
Yes.
Making that opportunity available in the world.
Yeah, it's a good way of looking at it. We public preceptors want to serve mitras worldwide who would like to deepen their understanding of the three jewels of the Dharma, and specifically of Triratna, specifically of Sangharakshita's teachings. And we want to support them, we want to help them all the way to ordination and beyond.
Which strikes me that that's an expression of those verses that you recite every morning, for all beings to be free from suffering, for them to have happiness.
Yeah.
It makes me think as well of that line from the Dhammapada, happy indeed we live, which connects back to this, I don't know, root inspiration of yours about spiritual community. That's the sort of heart of this responsibility, is creating a happy spiritual community.
Spiritual community. Yeah, that's right. I mean, that is so fundamental to our tradition. It's not about focusing on insight in a way that doesn't have that broad context of the whole of one's Dharma life. That's why I know over the years we've quite often had discussions about insight in the college. I mentioned I've been in the college for 20 years, and every time we have those discussions, everybody has come to the conclusion, the agreement, that if we're talking about insight, there are so many ways in which we deepen our insight or deepen our understanding of the way things are, to talk in wisdom language, our participation and contribution to the collective, to spiritual community. Certainly, meditation is centrally important and can be profoundly, powerfully transformational. But also other aspects of Triratna. Sangharakshita was very keen that we remember the distinctive features. I won't go through them all. You can no doubt look on the free Buddhist audio, the 6 distinctive features of the Friends of the Western Buddhist Order of Triratna. But for example, cultivation of the arts. These and many other ways are ways to deepening our Dharma practice. And yeah, if we're going to use the language of insight. And taking responsibility. Well, surely everyone's going to take responsibility in some way, not necessarily institutional responsibility, but everybody can look in their lives, how is taking responsibility? It may be, at a certain point, bringing up a family in a very productive, creative way. And specifically in Triratna, there are always ways that one can contribute, and many, many people do.
We all have to do the work. Hearing you talk about your path of responsibility and what that might mean, it's like looking in a mirror in a certain way. I find myself reflecting on my responsibilities such as they are. I'm going to broaden it out again. I want to come back to this beautiful collision between the vastness of this and then the deeply personal, quite everyday taking of responsibility, doing the work of one's life to make it meaningful, to live more happily with others in relationship, staying in relationship to yourself in a positive way, others in a positive way, and some vision of how we might live. The college does sit in relationship to a wide spiritual community that's very international these days, very diverse in lots of ways, multilingual, multicultural, many other institutions and structures, many thousands of people doing that work every day, and it's a very dynamic, alive relationship. Triratna itself has been through quite a decade, I think it's fair to say. Lots of change has happened. Some of that is the natural flow of generational change, time passing, the world changing around us. But the past decade has also included the death of our founder, Urgyen Sangharakshita. First and foremost, you were his friend, in a way amongst his very good friends, amongst his close friends. It would be good to hear, since we've been talking about the aspect of responsibility, what was the history of your friendship with Sangharakshita, and how has his death changed both your sense of relationship and the sense of your own work? Now that something has changed, something definitive has changed.
Yeah, thank you. I had the good fortune to be ordained by Sangharakshita. I didn't have a personal friendship with Sangharakshita for many, many years. For the first 25 years or so, I would write to him occasionally. I was on a number of seminars with him. I lived with him for a short while at Padmaloka community in Norfolk in the late 70s. But it was only in the beginning of this century, 2000, that I moved to a community where he was living, Birmingham, Margin Maloka. I got to know him. He would join us for evening meals. And then he's written about, he called it his annus horribilis, his horrible year. Actually, it was more like 2 years. I don't know what that would be in Latin. Annae horribili.
Possibly.
But I don't know whether Bob one actually says that. Since he was very literary, the piece he wrote, he didn't call him the Horribili. Or maybe he just didn't remember it like that. But my memory is for a couple of years, he had a lot of sleeplessness. He was treated with medication that made him anxious when he wasn't anxious. And it was pretty terrible. And I was one of the people who spent a lot of time with him. He's written about that. He's written about me staying up with him all night, one night, talking with him all through the night. So we became quite close, quite intimate. And then when I had responsibility as an international order convener, he used also to talk with me about issues in the order. So again, that brought us quite close, kind of organisationally or in terms of the spiritual direction of the order and movement, and that went right through the noughties. But I lived with Sangharakshita until 2013, for 13 years, as others of us did in Birmingham. And then I moved with him to our Adhisthana, our place of blessings here in Herefordshire. I moved here with him. I just stayed here for 6 months, and then I moved 5 miles away to Malvern But I continued to be his secretary and companion, and in the last 5.5 years of his life, I spent a lot of time with him, sometimes as his companion, sometimes staying overnight when his regular companions were away, and often as his stand-in secretary. And we had many conversations about many things.
Mm. And so how has his passing changed your sense of that relationship? It became very personal and very intertwined in quite a distinctive way, and also your sense of the work that you're doing as you step into this role.
Well, it kind of was personal. In some ways, it wasn't personal because I always felt basically I was serving him. I didn't expect to talk a lot about my life with him. Most of the time, I was seeing what he needed. Interestingly, when I look back on it, there were occasions when he would respond to something in my life very significantly, and they're very special memories. But most of the time, even if I'd been away for a couple of months somewhere, we just exchange very briefly, and then we just get on with what he needed to do. So when he died, I didn't feel attached to him personally. The experience I had, which I think is an experience that a lot of people had, was in a sense nothing much changed. And in that week after he died, I had been asked by Subhuti 18 years before to make plans for organising his funeral. So I was, you could say, the chair of one of the biggest projects of my life, actually. And even when I look back on that, I think that funeral and how that worked was one of the most important things that I could contribute to in my whole life. And I'm sure when I die, that will be the case. Oh, there were so many conditions that made that funeral possible. So many people were involved. You yourself, Chandradasa, were here with your team. There were conditions that were beyond our control, like rainbows appearing and the sun and so on. But when Sangharakshita died, my whole focus was on organising the funeral. But I felt, like a lot of us did, he was just with me. He was with us. And that's really how it's felt ever since. So I never, again, I don't think this is unusual. I think you've asked a lot of order members. I never really felt any disruption or grief, or not even really sad, because I felt he's given us what he needed to do. He'd fulfilled his mission. He often said he didn't want to live for a long time, and by which he meant just more and more decrepit. So he managed it really well, because he managed to die, as it were. Of course, who knows how these things happen, just like over a few days, didn't he?
That's right, yeah. I remember sitting in the small room down there, the small shrine room, with his body one night at like 2 a.m. I think we'd finished doing some piece of work that was setting up the funeral. And again, there was this very intimate setting, wasn't there? You could go and spend some time if you were here on the site. And the next day was the funeral, and suddenly the sort of huge influx of people, buses coming, an oddly, not celebratory atmosphere, but something quite positive and upbeat. And also, our job was to beam it out to lots of different people. So there's many thousands of people all over the world watching this thing. And you definitely had a sense of a collective again. We were definitely a community. It was one of those points you could almost touch and think,
you could.
Ah, this is, again, where these things collide. Very personal, the very big. And even the very big felt intimate. I remember that experience of sitting beside his body. I was watching Shenpen Hukum at 2 a.m, reciting from memory whole tranches of the Bodhicharyavatara over Sangharakshita's body. Just as his friend. She wasn't even in our community. She's just not a disciple of Sangharakshita, but a friend of the Dharma and a friend of the heart in that way. And it all really fused, didn't it? There was a real sense of being part of something.
Yeah.
And it's the sort of thing that can sustain you for quite a long time, isn't it? A bit like your ordination.
Mm.
People can touch back into that a long time.
People do. I think, well, I know some people who were here whose first contact with Triratna was the funeral, or if not absolute first contact, very early on. It was all about Sangharakshita. That was basically part of what he gave us, his funeral.
It's nice to stop actually and just remember that, and those kind of points of connection time. It's already 6 years ago. Time just moves on.
Yeah, nearly 6 years.
We're well through another decade.
Yeah.
I was evoking this big decade we'd had of lots of change. Another aspect of that we've touched on quite a bit together in our years of working has been this long process in Triratna of coming to terms with aspects of our ethical past. as a community. Sometimes our community has attracted quite strong criticism for aspects of the past. And it's led to some quite deep soul searching, which in a way is part of the same thing, like people with real integrity coming up against their own history, some of the conditions that have led to their experience now, and realising there's work to be done. It's really been all about ethics. There were aspects of Sangharakshita and his own sexual history that came up. There were aspects of our early developing culture that caused some lingering pain. When we were talking about it together, we were evoking it more, you were evoking it more, I should say, as something to do with the conduct of order members, the importance of being ethical, the importance of Triratna as a community being ethical, being trustworthy, and that being quite clear to people when they encounter us in the way that it was for us when we encountered it. And there's a real duty and, again, responsibility there. You were centrally involved, as I remember it, in helping us do that work of facing those kind of shadows and coming out of the other side of it with a renewed confidence, as it were. Mm. Do you feel that confidence abroad in Triratna these days in what is hopefully a more mature community where we've got a bit more self-awareness around the past? And is there more work to be done? Like, how did you see all of that work when you were involved?
Well, you were all involved with that, weren't we? Like, you, Chandradasa, were involved with that in terms of communications across the Jyoti very much in creating what I regard as very, very important and I hope a helpful resource, which is our Ethics in Triratna report put together and published in 2020, wasn't it, across the Jyoti? You chose a beautiful image, didn't you? Could you describe that image on the front page?
Yeah, I chose an image of a bowl that had been broken and repaired. But it had been repaired with gold. It's a traditional Japanese practice.
Yeah. I suppose, across the Jyoti, what you had in mind there is that no one would say that either Sangharakshita or Triratna was perfect in his history or in Triratna's history.
Yeah, and I think also that the process of reparation and that can be beautiful.
Yeah, process of repairing. My role when we were getting, understandably, a whole new amount of questions coming to the surface, they had been there in the past, and they came again. It was catalysed by a television programme, wasn't it, in England. One of my particular functions in the grouping that we put together was to converse with Sangharakshita about these things. So, for example, if you look on the website, you'll see these frequently asked questions. And we made a decision. In fact, I remember saying very early on in our discussions when we were looking into the rumours and the what actually had happened and so on, it's all on the website, that I didn't think we should be publishing anything behind Sangharakshita's back. And because I was the one who was spending time with Sangharakshita, as one of his secretaries, I was the one who needed to take to him anything that we wanted to say, and we followed that. Anything like that the chair of the college said to the order at the time of quite major upset, not everybody, but some to different degrees, and all of us would have been concerned. And certainly the so-called frequently asked questions, I think they're frequently asked questions part one and part two.
Yes.
Part two came 2 years later. All these I read to Sangharakshita with the questions and the answers. And some of them were, you know, very personal to him. I can't say I particularly enjoyed doing that, but he was completely up for it and felt he needed to hear it, not because he needed to control, because he needed to know what people were asking. And obviously those questions could be leading critical questions. Obviously, I also wanted to check, well, is the answer accurate as far as you're concerned? In my view, that website, we've done a good piece of work there. From what I hear, it has helped. That's not to say that questions won't keep coming up, particularly when people first make contact with Triratna. But I hope that that website will help, as well as, of course, fundamentally, crucially, talking to all the members that you know.
Yeah. We were talking yesterday, weren't we, about making sure in a way that it's easy to find that story, because it's important. If you're going to be trustworthy, people need to see completely transparently. And I remember being struck, because I worked on those frequently asked questions a lot. And I was working with our safeguarding officer and various other people doing some of the research for it. And I remember you telling me at the time that you were going to go and just talk to Sangharakshita about it, which I was really pleased about. I thought, oh, this is great. And the questions weren't his answers, but it was really important that we weren't just making stuff up. We weren't just coming into some sort of position of pseudo-objective judgment about it. We were presenting what we knew, what we could know, what evidence there was, etc. There was something beautiful about the reparation. It was also really difficult, wasn't it? It was difficult, not actually talking to Sangharakshita, if I remember, because I also had to talk to him directly about it. And he was very welcoming. I mean, I would hate people to be asking those questions about my life. Absolutely. But he was used to it, and he was very gracious in allowing me to talk to him about it when I needed to. But the pain side of it and the difficulty side of it, there's something that connects to that seam of gold, I should say, on your beautiful image of the bowl. It reminds me of the other image of there are golden Buddhas buried in the earth, but nobody knows they're there.
Right.
There was an aspect of that about it. We had to rediscover something with him and then in his absence. And it was all of a piece for me with sitting with his body in the shrine and being part of that marvellous funeral. We're serving the same thing. They're not at angles to each other. They're part of the same flow of something. The difficulty was part of it, and the beauty is part of it, but it's all part of a stream of work.
Yes, it was positive work. The ethics in Triratna work was positive work. It was necessary work. It was purifying work. It contributes to making Triratna more beautiful, and it needed to be done. It wasn't just some people are being awkward. Sometimes the questions came from misinformation, unfortunately, on the internet. So we had to answer those. No doubt the people who asked those questions, they believed what they read. So we had to clarify that. There were a lot of rumours, actually, even within Triratna about different things. And history is quite complex. It's quite nuanced. We've tried to address that without avoiding the basic ethical issues.
Yeah.
It's great to hear about you're going to see Sangharakshita, and he was gracious. You know, I quite often, as well as the frequently asked questions, there were other things that order members would sometimes write that were critical of him. And I remember near the end of his life, and he wasn't that well, saying, you know, are you sure you want to hear this? And he's saying more or less exactly the words, I need to hear this. If people have got criticisms, I just need to hear it. So he wouldn't necessarily have an answer, he would just hear it.
Good work, important work.
Yeah.
I want to pick up this theme of trust, and you're talking about establishing the conditions for trust and confidence in us as a community. I guess I've been very taken by, there seems to have been a very positive response within the order and community to you taking up this responsibility. I've heard many people expressing their trust and confidence and gladness in you doing so. And I'm sure you're going to be embarrassed by me asking you this question, but I think you can answer it with humility. I just wondered whether you had any reflections on why you have the trust of so many people. Mm. What are the qualities or values that you're bringing that make you trustworthy in this responsibility?
Mm. Well, obviously I'm glad that you're hearing from a number of people that they trust me, and I very much want that. I mean, that is really important, isn't it? I mean, if you have a responsibility which you want to serve, as I do want to serve each and every order member, I want to serve you if you're listening, or if you're a mitra asking for ordination, or if you're coming along and involving with Triratna, I want to serve you. So I would like you to trust me. I suppose those people who are saying they trust me, they must know me to some extent. So it might partly be that quite a lot of people will know me. I was international audit convener for quite a few years, and that might be partly why. I travelled around quite a lot, our different centres around the world and so on. But I think all I can say is I would like people to trust me, and I will certainly want to act in a way that will preserve that trust. Or if you didn't know me, that you will feel that you could trust me. What do you think, Carter Doty?
Well, I think
it is a slightly embarrassing question.
I think it is significant that you've been international order convener and have travelled around the world meeting with hundreds, thousands maybe, of order members and mitras. Because I imagine a lot of that work was listening. It was to do with getting to know people, expressing interest in their spiritual lives, care for their spiritual lives, and taking them in, listening. And then there was a whole load of work you did around the ethical issues in Triratna. Again, of listening. I think there's something about that that makes you very trustworthy. And I think you referred to this daily meditation practice, visualization of this Bodhisattva Manjushri. My experience of you is that your connection with him is strong and animates your activity and animates your life. And I imagine that is a practice that you've done almost daily since ordination. So I think there's something in that also that makes you trustworthy.
Thank you. Well, one thing I would mention that when you were talking, I was remembering, because it hasn't been mentioned yet, is that I spent 7 years living in India, and I also visited India many times. Since I left living full-time in India at the end of 99, I visited many times over the last 24 years. I was last there in January. And so for me, and I know actually for the college, that was one of the plus points about me taking on being chair of the college, that at least generations in India, perhaps, maybe not the most recent ones, they don't know me so much, they know me well. I feel very faithful to whatever connections I have and friendships. They may not be very sort of close personal friendships, but I do feel that. And I do my best. I hope people will say the same in 5 years' time.
So you're going to be becoming the fifth chair of the College of Public Preceptors. And I have this sense that each chair has their own distinctive personality and their own distinctive contribution to make. And I was wondering whether you might have an image or some way of expressing what you would love for your contribution to be. What is the sort of gift? Another way of thinking about this might be, I was thinking about the image of the thousand armed Avalokiteshvaras, the image for the order, each hand holding a ritual implement, symbolic of some contribution. What are you holding?
I do have an answer to that, at least at the moment, and it has been with me quite strongly the last few months, and that is the Greater Mandala. To me, this is one of Sangharakshita's many brilliant teachings, so I can't say the most brilliant because there are so many brilliant teachings. It's a teaching found in the seminar on the Ratnaguma Samchayagatha, the Perfection of Wisdom text. This word responsibility keeps on coming up, doesn't it? And it can sound quite sort of heavy, sort of serious and so on, but I don't see it like that. I see responsibility as something that I would like it for me and for anybody else having responsibility in Triratna to have a kind of light and joyful feel. So the image of the greater mandala of aesthetic appreciation is like, whatever you're doing, it's coming from a place where you don't need to prove anything, but you see something worthwhile to do, so you want to do it. So what Sangharakshita says is, quite often it's called in the order the greater mandala of uselessness. Although as far as I can find from the text, he never actually said the greater mandala of uselessness. But what he did say was that you're living in a life where you don't need to do anything. So you're happy to do nothing. So I'd like to feel I don't have to do anything. And in fact, if there's nothing to do, do nothing. Don't be a busy, busy kind of institutional person. I've got to do this, got to do that. And even literally have time, you do nothing. And then when you do something, you do it from this deeper place, which Sangharakshita says, that is, obviously, that's far beyond me, but that is the Bodhisattva activity. And it's the Bodhisattva play. And that comes from the greater mandala, which is a greater mandala of aesthetic appreciation, which means your whole life is surrounded by beauty, or you see beauty. It's something like that. So I would like to try to work like that, and I would try to encourage anybody I'm working with to work like that. So that's an image. And actually, I know that I'm pushing an open door, because I know that all college members would like, and probably do better than me already, work like that. So I'm just going to aspire to do that. And lots of board members work like that. At the same time, I think most of us would recognise it's not always easy. Sometimes you just get stressed, and it's just all this stuff coming into your inbox and so on. So then it's like, stop and take a breath. And I think for all of us, everybody, whatever, again, that word responsibility you have, for me, the greater mandala of aesthetic appreciation is just a wonderful vision, really.
There's a parallel there with how you took on the role of the college, I'm hearing. You were saying that you were ready to have a quiet life and play the piano in a way, this greater mandala space, but then there was a spontaneous response to the calling.
Yeah, and I'm still going to play the piano.
Yay, I'm glad. You're going to garden? You're going to do a bit of gardening?
Yeah, a bit of gardening.
Excellent. That vision, it sounds like the perfect way, in a way, to leave this conversation, because it's opening out into something. And that's been one of the senses I've had listening to you today, is that watching a path in the woods open out into fields, into maybe the path you talked about through the muddy field, around the side of the field. And I love this sense of you tending to the beautiful. It's a very moving evocation of what it is to be living a Dharma life. Anyway, that's all we've got to do, is tend to the beautiful, even when our inboxes are full. I mean, I really hope you find what you need, because your inbox is about to fill up even more. You're going to have a lot to do, a lot of responsibility, but it's very encouraging to hear you be in touch with that space and have that sense that it's possible. It's possible to meet the demands and to stay in touch with that. Well, thank you to both of you for being here, just unfolding this quite mysterious job. In a way, it's quite a beautiful path. Thanks to you, Kastuti, for coming along and being on the team and asking such wonderful questions.
You're welcome.
And Mahamati, thanks to you for all your time and all of the love that we've just captured. Congratulations on taking this responsibility, and good fortune in it. But also, I have great confidence that whatever happens, you will meet this.
Mm, thank you.
It's great that we've got you doing this for us, with us, in collaboration.
Thank you, Tandrasa.
And thank you for listening to such a full conversation about the challenge of a Dharma life and the opportunity of a Dharma life and the gift of it. You can hear many more episodes of the podcast in the archive. Lots of voices, lots of stories, all hopefully reaching for something of the same mysterious beauty. We'll be back soon with more episodes. For now, please take care. Take care of each other. Take care of the community. And we'll see you soon. Bye for now.